Hi, everybody. It is February 27th, Sunday. It's a beautiful day out here in LA. It's supposedly going to start warming up, which I'm not thrilled about. I really would like to have still some more winter and then an early spring, but not summer yet. And it's supposed to be up around 80 in the next couple of days. And it's not my cup of tea. I'm really a much cooler weather person than a summer person. But I was thinking about songs today, and one of the artists I had featured a long time ago was the fabulous Janis Ian, and I discovered another project I had done with her. And so I wanted to play something from that, but I was looking up her musical career on Wikipedia here, and I'll make this as concise as I can, but it's really fascinating. And then I'll get to the song. According to this, I'm going to be looking up here, reading. I have got my computer. My phone is leaning against my computer screen. So that's why I'm always, if I'm doing anything like that, I'm kind of looking away because I'm trying to read what's above the phone. But so let's go on. Enough of my old babbling, rambling here. At the age of 14, Ian wrote and recorded her first hit single, Society's Child, about an interracial romance forbidden by a girl's mother and frowned upon by her peers and teachers. Produced by George Morton and released three times from 65 to 67. Now, the thing after her, when she wrote this, she was 14 years old when she wrote this. So Society's Child became a national hit upon its third release after Leonard Bernstein featured it in a late April 1967 CBS TV special titled Inside Pop, The Rock Revolution. God, I love Leonard Bernstein, his young people's concerts and stuff. He did more to introduce the audience to music than anybody else. He was so remarkable. The song's theme of interracial relationships was considered taboo by some radio stations, who withdrew or banned it from their playlists accordingly. In her 2008 autobiography, Society's Child, Ian recalls receiving hate mail and death threats as a response to the song, and mentions that a radio station in Atlanta that played it was burned down. In 1967, Society's Child reached number 14 on the Billboard Hot 100. The single sold 600,000 copies, and the album sold 350,000 copies. This is an interesting paragraph. At the age of 16, Ian met comedian Bill Cosby backstage at a Smothers Brothers show where she was promoting Society's Child. Since she was underage, she was accompanied by a chaperone while touring. After her set, Ian had been sleeping with her head on her chaperone's lap, an older female family friend. According to Ian in the 2015 interview, she was told by her then manager that Cosby had interpreted their interaction as lesbian, and as a result had made it his business to warn other television shows that Ian wasn't suitable family entertainment and shouldn't be on television because of her sexuality, thus attempting to blacklist her. Although Ian would later come out, she states that at the time of the encounter with Cosby, she had only been kissed once by a boy she had a crush on in daylight at a summer camp. I mean, I just love the fact that Bill Cosby has got a moral code and saying she's unsuitable as he's out raping and pillaging the countryside. It's unbelievable, the fall from grace that this complete scumbag went through. Yeah, you know, the fact that he's on the streets again is pretty horrifying due to a technicality. Ian relates on her website that Society's Child was originally intended for Atlantic Records, and the label paid for her recording session. Atlantic subsequently returned the master to her and refused to release it. Ian relates later that year Atlantic's president at the time, Jerry Wexler, publicly apologized to her for this. The single and Ian's 67 debut album, which reached number 29 on the charts, were finally released on Verve Forecast. In 2001, Society's Child was inducted into the Grammy Hall of Fame, which honors recordings considered timeless and important to to music history. Her first four albums were released as a double CD entitled Society's Child, the Verve Recordings, in 1995. It goes on and on. It's a real fascinating story of what she said, the journey she has traveled. and well worth looking up just to see what can happen to a person in this business by stigmatization, you know, that I think that's a word. And, you know, fighting, you know, narrow-minded powers that be. But it is an end result, though. Her music will go on past a lot of these other people in a positive way. The thing I'm going to visit is we did one track on this album, and it was an album called Uncle Wonderful in 1984. Let me see. Oh, it also, you know, talked about how she's worked as a columnist, and she's also a science fiction writer. She's loved the genre and has written in that style. So this song that I've got here is called The Night, and it was produced by the fabulous Brooks Arthur and Janis Ian, engineered by Bob Merritt and mixed by the great Bill Schnee and mastered by Bernie Grundman. And we recorded this at Richard Perry's Studio 55 down in Hollywood. Worked a lot at Studio 55, doing everything from Leo Sayer to the Pointer Sisters to kind of you name it. That was one of the most active studios in town for a long time. Plus, it was just down the street from a place called Nicodel's, which was a restaurant that had the best chopped salad I ever had. Every time I was going to be working at Studio 55, I was already going, man, chopped salad. Because the musicians, that was always the great thing on sessions. Like, everybody would arrive and immediately start talking, what are we going to order for lunch or dinner? It's like, immediately, it's like, musicians, that's the zone right there. But the band on this is myself, Rick Schlosser on drums, who toured with James Taylor, did a lot of sessions with Rick. And I believe Rick lives in Mexico now. The great Buzz Featon on guitar, and Peter Schless, Chris Page, and Janis all taking care of keyboard duties on this. But it's real different when you listen to the early stuff, like Society's Child and At 17. This is a whole other ball game, but this just shows the creative process as people evolve in their musical journey. So here's This Night, and this is from 1984. Let's grab that downbeat.
Until I cry the night away.
She's good. Great writer, great musician, great voice. She's a real American treasure, you know, and a long, really amazing career. One of the things I've enjoyed so much is like, sometimes I'll look at, you know, while I'm trying to sort all these things out, I'll come up with like Wikipedia or any of these things, and I start to look at checking out stuff I've worked on, and they'll list an artist. But they list the artist's name, but they don't necessarily tell you that you've done maybe six albums with that artist, or there's a Japanese artist who I've done at least 20-some albums with. They just list their name. So for me, it's really fun to discover, you know, projects that we did, you know, 5, 10 years apart, and how things evolved for them during that period musically. And she's certainly one of those artists that shows growth and development and change and stylistically moving into different directions. And plus, she's just great people, really great people. So I got some more work to do here. A lot of stuff to take care of. Did another track yesterday for a friend and sent that off, and he's happy, so I'm happy with that. And I've done a couple of projects for people that I'm going to actually film myself playing them, because they're going to make little videos for their projects, and they want the players to do that so they can, you know, put together a little montage of everybody. So I'm going to take care of that. But the hard part, the hard thing today is, you know, playing music for you, looking out at a beautiful day out here, fed the puppies and all that, and just thinking about halfway around the world, the suffering that is taking place right now, the horror of that's being inflicted upon a population is just beyond comprehension. When I see the pictures on the news of families huddled in you know, subway stations, with little kids holding their puppies and kittens and stuff, because the buildings that they live in are, you know, targets and being blown up. And they're all trying to get out of the country, but all the men are being asked to stay there and fight this army that's rolling over them. It's just unfathomable that at the same moment in time, we're like, we're sitting here and I'm making a video for you and trying to bring some music to you and just have this relationship that somewhere else, that this monstrous situation is taking place that there will be an end to it, but I don't see it at this point. There's so many things in play right now, but just the fact that in this day and age that somebody just decides, oh, I think I'm going to take that country and just go for it. And especially when you're not supported by your own people, this is a personal, ego, maniacal power move here. And it's just, it saddens me to no end to think of the suffering and horrors being inflicted upon a population. You know, and I'll probably get some more people come on that are telling, like the other day they came on here and told me I'm full of shit and my head's up my ass and all that stuff. And that, you know, it's all the Ukrainians' fault. You know, they're the ones that caused all this. It's like when the trolls come on, boy, they come on steroids, you know. But that's why I block them. You're gone. You are gone immediately. You are a cancer to the world we live in, and I really have I'm not going to waste time with you. I mean, we can all form our own opinions as to what's going on in the world, but I'm not going to sit here and have somebody start, you know, spitting in my face while I'm trying to air my feelings in this. And also, you know, we're still in the time of COVID. So my heart goes out to the people working so hard. I have friends that are long haul COVID. You know, they've been for 6 months, 8 months, they've been dealing with side effects of COVID that are not diminishing, or they're diminishing incredibly slowly. So the people that are in the hospitals, especially putting themselves in harm's way to help people through this difficult time, you have my heart and soul. You're something very special. So take good care. I'll be back tomorrow. I'm going to get these other things done and then figure out what I'm going to do the rest of the day. I've already been out this morning and watered all my roses and plants and stuff, and get that done before it gets too warm. And that's the joy of home ownership, as they say. So take good care, and I'll see you all tomorrow. Bye-bye.